So if you have good pictures, send them to me. I'll make another one of these. You know, many of these pictures, the camera doesn't quite do it justice, you know, how that goes. That one particular sunset there, I was coming back over Grayback, looking out over Cave Junction, it was just unbelievable. Captured on that,
right,
is right. Pretty stunning.
It's pretty realistic.
Yeah.
If you use Kodachrome, chrome, it would accentuate the warmer colors. Ektachrome, the cooler colors. You know, and of course it depends on the shutter speed, but still.
Right. And you have a computer that's interpreting this versus somebody that's actually right there looking at it. Who's got some amazing pictures is Greg McDonald. He's got some phenomenal stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Especially of his wildlife.
Yeah, I know.
Speaking of wildlife, did that deer ever run away from you? Well, good morning. Glad that you guys could make it. I know that there's a few folks that are out sick. Some are traveling. So let's start our day with prayer, and we'll get to rolling. Father, thank you so much for this day. And thank you, Lord, for the blessing of being able to be together. We pray for those that are not able to make it here today, that you would just bless them with strength and wellness. Lord, I know that many are under the weather as the cold and crud is rolling around town. So, Lord, we pray that you would just touch them, help them to feel better and recover quickly. And for those that are not sick, Lord, we pray just protection over them. Lord, as we open up your word today, may we be reminded again what it means to be an example, to live life by your love. And Lord, as we sing songs of praise to you, I pray, Father, that you would be blessed with our worship. We thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that you have given to us to join together with many around the world today to proclaim your name and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. One day when heaven is filled with his praises, one day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men, my example is he. Word became flesh, suffering anguish, despised and rejected, bearing all sin, my Redeemer is he. Hands that heal nations, stretched out on a tree, took nail for me, living he loved me, dying he saved. Thank you. You know, that first verse says that he dwelt among men as an example. And I know that many a time, we're not always the best example of what it means to be a Christian. We're going to talk a little bit about that today, about setting an example and what that means as far as love goes.
Miracle worker, promise keeper, light
makes the planet spin, tells the tide when it should rise, puts the color in my eye. The same God who makes the seasons change knows the number of the stars, every secret in my heart, all my doubt, all my question, and every fear I have about what might happen. You're the same God with me in the middle of it all. God, you're catching every tear as it falls. I know you'll never change, even when I'm feeling far away. You love me the same. You're the same. You're with me in the middle of it all. You're catching every tear as it falls. I know you'll never change, even when I'm feeling far away. You love me the same. All right, now I know we're a little ways from Christmas, but I don't know about you. I've seen Christmas in the stores like for the past month. So why not have a little more Christmas in church, right? So I sing these things all year long. So Heather can attest to that. So. Get the timing on this one right. It's hard. This is a newer song for me, and they play it a little differently, so bear with me. Start that again because I can't start that high. It'll take me a little while to get this, okay? But this is a great song. So, have I practiced this a lot? Yes. It's hard to not go back to old school though. Let me start. Joy overflowing, Father, we know that in you we have life, and we have an abundant life at that. Lord, you came to take away the frustration from not having answers. Father, we know that in this life you haven't necessarily come to take away the trouble. In fact, Lord, you promised us that in this life you will have tribulation, we will have trouble. But Father, I am so grateful that you went away to prepare a place for us, that where you are, we may be also. And, Lord, that it is going to be different than this world. It is going to be a world without sin, without difficulty, without trouble, without tear. Because, Lord, you said that you will wipe away our tears. And Father, we want to set a good example of you. We want to live our lives by your love and live in such a way that others will see the joy that we have in you, knowing that our sins are forgiven, knowing that our home is not of this world, but in you and in heaven. Father, during this time of year, as we begin to celebrate your coming, Father, we rejoice greatly that you have made it possible for us to be with you forever. So we thank you, we praise you, in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, well, prayer request. Operation Christmas Child, again, be in prayer for that ministry as they are coming to that period of time where many will be receiving their boxes and hearing about Jesus and things of that nature. So pray for that ministry, pray for the kids, the families that are going to be dealing with, the difficulties of life after that happens as well. So continue to pray for that. Again, on the counter back there, we'll start collecting already for the next go-round. So feel free to toss in your loose change and things of that nature. And we'll continue to pray for that. Pray for our government. Many people have been surprised, I guess you could say, by the outcome of the elections. You know, we heard in the news about the red wave is coming and things of that nature, and that the Republicans will be there to save the day. Well, you know, one thing that I've learned over the years is God is not surprised by this whatsoever. Even though the media is, or even the Republicans or Democrats are surprised at this outcome. But God isn't. Why? Because he's the one that places those that are in authority in a position to accomplish his will. And so we can look at it and say, well, what a bummer. But I would suggest to you, don't say what a bummer, but rather say thank you, Lord, because you are accomplishing what you see fit. And we know that in what could very likely be the last days that we're living in, things are going to get a little more heated. They're going to get a little more topsy-turvy as the world begins to look for a leader, somebody that can lead them, somebody they can put their trust in. But yet, are they going to find that person? No. Why? Because there's only one who has done right by all of us, and that is Jesus. And so we can put our trust in him and our hope in him, and not so much in government. Yes, we go out and we vote and we do those things, and you hope for change and things of that nature. But one thing that will never change is the goodness of God, and we can always rely upon him and the promises that he's given to us. So keep praying for those that are in authority over us, even as the Lord tells us to do in Romans. Pray for our communities. You know, there's many people along the Klamath that are struggling, not just in a financial way, but those that have lost their houses, those that have lost all of their stuff. Just continue to pray that the Lord will sustain them through especially what looks to be a longer winter. So pray for the recovery and an opportunity, how, you know, we might help as individuals. So pray for our youth, Sunday school. Robin's not here today as she is hanging out with family, her dad and mom, and she also has the grandkids with her as Zach and Abby are celebrating their fifth anniversary. It was actually last weekend, but hey, there's a three-day weekend this weekend, so anyhow, pray for our youth. Schools aren't what they used to be. It used to be about just reading and writing and mathematics and science and, you know, things of that nature, but we have switched gears, and you know, they're more into dealing with computers and, you know, stuff like that. Well, that introduces a whole host of problems into their lives, and we know that computers and videos and things of that nature, especially like the TikToks and the Facebook type stuff, can really change the way the brain functions. It gets a lot of dopamine from that. So even though they can be tools of learning, they can also be very difficult for our kids. So pray for them. They don't go to the library anymore, and they don't do some of that stuff, which means we need to be more diligent at home, or even here at church, to teach them the word, teach them the things that they're not necessarily going to get in school. And our unsaved loved ones, we've got a few names up here that have been on here for a while, but this is just a reminder for us to continue to pray for those that maybe haven't made a decision for the Lord, and the time I feel is short. You never know. You can be here today and gone tomorrow. You know, a simple illness can wipe you out. Car accidents. Early this week, dealt with a young gal that was lost somewhere between Selma and Hoopah. And that was kind of interesting to see that unfold and to work diligently to find some answers. Ultimately, it turned out very well as they were able to go up with snowmobiles and retrieve her from Grayback, you know, which was buried in snow after last weekend. And so those are good things, but many times we don't see those outcomes. So we don't necessarily know whether we're going to be here tomorrow or not, which means today is an important day. Today is a day that really could, and we'll see that in today's scripture, be the day of someone's salvation. So we need to kind of pay attention to our loved ones and pray for them and encourage them in the Lord. We can do that through not only church, but also groups like Clapper, the Navigators, the Over 70 Surf Ministries, CSN, Summit Ministries, things like that. Continue to pray for those. Continue to pray for churches, even in our own communities, that they would have a good effect and that they would work together to accomplish the Lord's will. As far as those that are dealing with issues of cancer, a new name on the list, Julie DeBoer. She is a good friend and the mother-in-law to Pete Corson, who, of course, we know has already gone to see the Lord. So we have prayer requests for her. She didn't even know she had cancer or any issues. She doesn't seem to be struggling with it, but now she's going into chemo and that kind of stuff. So those treatments can be quite difficult, so pray for her if you would. Dory, doing pretty well. Got to meet with her the other night, and it's just, she's got such a great attitude through the whole thing, even through the aches and the pains. Currently, she's having some pain in her hands and kind of in her neck from her scoliosis that's pitching fits. And, you know, this time of year, it's not exactly easy when you get the weather changes. Boy, it's like you can kind of feel it in your joints. A few little aches and pains I have, but, you know, when you've been around a few more years, you know. You were friends with Noah, weren't you? You have a few more than I do. So pray for those. Pray for Dory and Joni, who is recovering from her cancer and surgery. And then, of course, Frank, as he continues in a mode of health, which is wonderful. So praise the Lord for that. Other medical health, etc. Jimmy, that's his back recovery. Continue to pray for him there. Dolly, with her knee. This time of year is quite frustrating for her. Buster for health. Stan in Virginia. I got to talk to him the other day at the post office. I said, "How you doing?" And he's like, "Not so good." You know, boy, it's rough getting old. Don't do it. You know, so pray for Stan in Virginia. My dad, he's in good spirits. He gets to hear from his surgeon this Thursday, kind of find out what the plan is and the approach that they will take for his back. So be in prayer for that. Denny and Donna, as they deal with the issues of dementia, as Denny continues on there, he's doing pretty good. He doesn't seem to necessarily be getting too much worse, which is a blessing. Judy Peabody's mom for health. Terry Everett for health. Candace with lupus. Debbie Taylor's mom for just continued care. Dan Bushy for that continued care as he deals with leftover from cancer and things of that nature that follow all of that. So continue to keep him in your prayer. The folks in Ukraine had a pretty good victory in pushing Russia out of one of their towns. It was a pretty big blow. And there's been rumors that even Putin is talking maybe peace. But, you know, I wouldn't trust him. He's been there before and said those kinds of things. So Brenda Franklin, as she kind of deals with more of the end of life type issues, that there would be peace and joy in her heart and that reassurance of her salvation. Jean with strokes, Mark with diabetes, Mike and Mike that return to the Lord, Regina, the kids' move. And then, of course, a new one, which we got asked here yesterday, which is the mother-in-law of Heather, but Josh's mom, and Pat that works up at Napa, his mom in the hospital with sepsis. So pray for that. She seems to be doing a little better, but it was kind of touch and go there at the beginning, so pray that she was able to move through that.
I just received another call that she has taken a step back again.
So
she's speaking nonsensically, and they're not sure what else is going on. He wasn't able to talk to the nurses or anything. He was just talking to her. He was able to get her on the phone, but
yeah,
there wasn't much to that conversation, so he's exhausted trying to keep everybody updated and trying to keep it together because he's the only one currently other than me that can in the family. So
it's not an easy thing to work through illness, and there's other things in life and in your body that contribute to a lot of those things that make it a little more difficult to as you all well know. So continue to pray for those that are ill, even as much as a little cold, that kind of thing. Other requests, things that got going on? Bob?
Yeah, we need to pray for Lou's shoulder. He's in a little pain right now.
Yeah.
A shoulder issue. And some good news.
Well, you shouldn't be wrestling with Bob. He's a little bigger than you.
You're right.
Yes, we will pray for your shoulder for sure.
And the other thing is some good news. Friday night, Lou and I were informed by Louie, his son, that he's cancer-free.
Oh, wonderful. Yeah. Praise the Lord for that. Yeah. So
that's a good one.
That is. Awesome. Lisa.
So I guess Barbara Geidel's friend that was, is that your, is that dead?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Karen Dancy was asking for prayers this morning for her son, Kevin. And then I just like to pray for all of our veterans on this weekend.
Absolutely.
So
absolutely.
That's what I have. Thanks.
Yeah. So, yes, Kevin deals and struggles with diabetes, and he has his ups and downs with that as well, so we can certainly put him on there. And, yes, we will pray for our veterans for sure. Anybody else? Jody.
For those in chronic pain, my dad's dealing with it, and his best friend's dealing with it, and his best friend's wife's dealing with it, plus they have to take care of two daughters and a toddler. So their life is pretty hard right now.
Wow. Dealing with chronic pain, and then sometimes kids can be a pain in the hind end, you know.
One has multiple sclerosis,
but
and the other one is Asperger's, and then she's the one that had it.
Yeah,
so it's,
but
it's a big,
God says that they are a joy in our lives, and I'll tell you what, they definitely bring patience into view and things of that nature for sure. But if they have struggles with special needs, that poses an even more difficult situation. So yes, we will definitely pray for your dad and for the family there. So anybody else?
Yeah.
David.
So I've had the live on Clapper going, and
okay,
a bunch of people have prayer requests that they want us to lift up, and I'll just go down and we can just lift it up. One gal needs to be motivated to walk only in the Spirit. Another gal asked to not be so stressed out and depressed, and for her relationship with her father. Another one asked for those hurting and those who feel lost and alone. And she didn't ask for this, but I'll just tell you that she's actually just starting to get into the Word. And so also prayers for her to understand what she's reading. She's never read the Bible before, and so she just really wants to understand. And then also for those facing religious persecution in China and Yemen, and for the folks in Yemen as a whole, not just the religious persecution, but as a whole. So
yeah, definitely.
Amen.
Okay. We will definitely lift those up in our requests as well. Anybody else? Okay. Well, Lord Jesus, we thank you so much that you have made yourself available to us and to our needs. And so, Father, this list, these things that we have brought before you, we pray that you would minister, touch, heal, move, restore, redeem. Father, we thank you for hearing each of these. For those that are needing to learn about you, to study, Father, give them direction, and Lord, help them to be able to plug into a church that can really teach the Word, to receive your full counsel and not just bits and pieces. Lord, we also want to lift up a special prayer for our veterans. Father, could you just put your arm around them? Give them a hug for each of us. Lord, as difficult as war has been in this nation and in this world, Father, it really moves us, Father, to know that people are willing to lay down their life for those who they consider to be friends. Father, we pray that you would touch them, that you would bless them for their service in our country. Father, we owe them a great debt. And yet, Lord, many of them aren't doing it because of the medals. They're doing it because they believe in a country that was founded upon you and to fight for the rights of freedom, even when we don't see eye to eye. Father, thank you for their service. Lord, thank you that we can continue to bring our requests to you. May we continue to rejoice in you, even when we can't rejoice in the situation. May we continue to bring you thanks and to make our requests made known to you, and Lord, to give you that opportunity to bring peace to each situation, even at times when we don't understand what is going on. Even when we're dealing with kids that might be difficult in special needs or chronic pain or whatever the case may be, Father, help us to see you at work. Help us to know that you are going to bring resolution and that one day we will all receive a new body. No more tears because they will have been wiped away. No more hurt because you will have taken that from us. Father, thank you for the blessing of being able to bring these requests to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, men's prayer breakfast, Friday, 7 a.m., Bible church, and the menu this week is?
French toast.
French toast.
Waffles.
Biscuits and gravy, right? Yeah.
Biscuits and gravy.
Biscuits and gravy.
We're going to put it to a
bowl. Wednesday night Bible study, Assembly of God, 6 p.m., that potluck and book study about prayer. that's going well. And then, of course, continue to pray for our youth and our Sunday school. And then birthdays. Jody has an upcoming birthday, and I found out today that one of our new folks that is coming, although they're not here today. You want that cupcake? Yeah. his name is Dylan, and they were here last week, but they're not here this week. They're kind of new to the area, living in Syed, and so we'll sing Jody and Dylan happy birthday.
Floyd Henderson has a birthday today, too.
And Floyd does as well, huh?
Yeah.
Okay, well.
That's right, Floyd, yeah.
Yeah. Well, let's sing them happy birthday. So happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Jody, Dylan, and Floyd. Happy birthday to you, and happy birthday to you, and to Jesus be true. May God bless you and keep you your whole life through. So Jody said she wants a cupcake. So. Okay, well, as far as the Middle East goes, E stands for empty. I'm not going to do it today. We did a lot last week. We'll maybe get into some of that stuff this week. But it is interesting to watch the ebb and flow of things. And I think the world is waiting to see what is going to happen when it comes to the other E, which is our elections and how we're going to, you know, figure things out. And the other E, I guess you could say, is environment. You know, everybody's chasing this, you know, idea that things are going to change, and that somehow or another we have power over, in a sense, what you would consider or what many would consider to be Mother Nature. Who is in charge of this world? It's not a mother, and it's not nature, but rather, sadly, it's the enemy. when we were in the Garden of Eden, what took place there? God gave us dominion over the earth. And what did we do? We sinned and signed the paper over to Satan. So many of the storms, many of the difficulties, many of the tragedies that we're seeing from what we would consider to be an environmental perspective is actually, I believe, the enemy. Even as we saw that in the New Testament when Jesus was in the boat and his disciples thought he was going to, that they were all going to die, rather, and that he should have been up and, you know, doing something to help them paddle to the other side. But that was the cool thing about that particular chapter is when Jesus said, you know, take us to the other side, he intends to get there in spite of what is going on in our environment. And we can talk about it, and I'm all for doing things to help, but they've got to be reasonable. And people are hurting. So when you think about that, think about the people in Ukraine that are going to be going through difficult times as far as, heating and things of that nature. Our own folks here in town that are going to have a difficult time because those little trailers don't come with wood stoves and energy is expensive. So be praying for many in regard to that kind of thing. But also we are told in the scripture to pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And we need to continue to pray for those folks as they go through some bumpy times as far as their elections go. So, all right. Well, the kids have already gone off to their youth study. So you and I get to turn back to our chapter by chapter verse-by-verse study in 2 Corinthians chapter 6. We're going to talk about living by love. What does that mean? I say I love my family. I love my wife. I love a good hot fudge Sunday ice cream. Those little waffle things that they put in there that they give you on the airplane, those are really good as well. That burger looks amazing. I don't know how you eat it, but hey, who doesn't love a good cheeseburger or good food? A lot of people sadly love money. And people would say that money is the root of all evil. That is incorrect. It is the love of money when you've made it your God. And hey, a good old classic car, you know, it's kind of hard to beat some of those. The electronic stuff kind of bugs me a bit because it's when it goes bad, it's hard to fix, you know. And then boy, there's a lot of people that love their sports, isn't there? So we say I love a lot of things, but when I say I love my kids, but then I turn right around and I also say I love cheeseburger or I love ice cream, we have one word, don't we, for love. And yet, in Greek and Hebrew, there are many words. If we just look at the Greek, there are several different versions. Lisa, did you have a question? I thought I saw your hand. Oh, okay. Throwing something at Frank back there. Shh. You're quiet, right? So in the Greek, we're just going to go over a handful of these. Phileo is where we kind of come up with the city name Philadelphia, or the city of brotherly love. So phileo is that brotherly kind of friendship type love that we have with the folks around us. Philousia is a self-love. It sounds very similar to a brotherly love, but it's more that you're kind of in love with yourself. You know, we would call it a little bit narcissistic. Okay. Storge, which is a love for family. Pragma, which is an enduring love, that long-term kind of lasting love. Ludus, which is a playful or kind of flirtatious kind of love. Eros, a romantic, more of a sexual kind of love. And then agape, which is that love that you have from God and for God. So there's many different things. And that's one of the reasons why the Lord gave us the scriptures in Hebrew and in Greek. Why? Because they're very descriptive languages. A lot of people would say that, you can't necessarily interpret the Bible correctly every single time. It's open to interpretation, but there's a reason that God gave us very descriptive languages in the original text, and that is so that we can't just make it up and make it say what it shouldn't say. So God would say there's all different types of love, and you and I intuitively know that. I have many friends, but I don't love them the same way that I love my kids. I don't love them the same way that I love the Lord. It's different. There's nothing wrong about being different. It's just different. And we understand that intuitively. But in English, what do we say? I love. There's just one word. We're pretty simple, easygoing in that kind of thing. Plus, we didn't want to have to study that much more in English class, right? So as we talk about love and learning to live by love, we're also going to be talking about setting a good example. As partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it. The problem with the church at Corinth is, although they were loving, they were somewhat loving the wrong things. They were looking at worldly things and trying to incorporate church into worldly things. Well, that's like putting light and darkness together. It just doesn't happen. You know, the other day, it was raining, snowing, and so I put Brooklyn and Cade in the car because every day I get to take Brooklyn to school. And Cade likes to come with. And being it's only a block away, it's real simple. Well, it was snowing, so I thought, well, we'll just drive down there instead of walk. And so when we came back, I plopped Cade in the front seat, and I noticed something out of the corner of my eye. And I've noticed this about him before. He pays attention to details, little details. He tries to understand how things work. And he watched as I put the key into the car and turned it on. And then as I grabbed the little button for the shifter and pulled it back into drive, and he made me nervous. Why? Well, he's already turned on his mom's car. He knows how to do that. And now he's looking at grandpa's. So lock up your cars. Make sure that you... But Cade pays attention to detail. He wants to know how things work. Many of us are like that. We want to understand how things work, how things are going to operate, and things of that nature. But when we try and take something that is godly, a life that should be lived for the Lord, and try and blend it with things of the world and say, well, we need to make church more about, sporty things or encouraging things, or we really change the dynamic of what God intended in the scriptures. Many would say, let's be less churchy. Well, I'm not so much against that, because church has become a little bit strange, I think, over the years to a certain extent. We have done things in church that are not appropriate, mostly because we want to get great and wonderful feelings. Because, well, just teaching the word isn't good enough. You know, nobody wants to study. They just want to hear a good word and an encouraging word and then move on in life. We have become the kind of TikTok version of church. Just give it to me in 1 minute. But that is not what God said when it comes to his word. His word is perfect. It doesn't return empty, where many of the things of this world do. And so he would say, I want you to study, to show yourselves approved, workmen that need not be ashamed. I want you to rightly divide the word of truth. Don't do it with the manner in which you're doing it. Well, if God is gracious, then we should just be able to do whatever we want in church and sin however we want, because if we don't sin, then God's grace won't abound. That was the idea in the church of Corinth. They were doing evil things in order to, well, God's grace can then come in and cover us. But that's backward thinking. It's taking the scriptures and twisting them into something that he never intended. God didn't say don't sin because he just wanted to, you know, control us. Why does he say I don't want you to sin? Because he wants us to not hurt. Sin, the wages of sin, those things that come with sin, is what? Death. And so God says, as you and I, as the church, partner together, which is kind of amazing when you think about it, that God would ask you, that God would ask me to be his partner in setting an example is kind of unbelievable. It's quite loving, to say the least. So God says, as God's partners, we beg you not to accept this marvelous gift of God's kindness and then ignore it, which means that we shouldn't ignore the things of God. Don't just come to church and have church or do church. God, what do you want me to do? Lord, I know that I'm here today so that I can set an example. I know that I'm tuning in today so that I might set an example for those that I'll be coming in contact with this week. So what do you want me to see? What do you want me to know this week in chapter 6? Well, God says, at just the right time, I heard you. On the day of salvation, I helped you. Indeed, the right time is now. Today is the day of salvation. So, Lord, I'm going to bump into people this week that need to hear of your forgiveness. Yes. That need to hear that in spite of what our governments do around the world, God, your government is in control. And that we need to get on board with that. We need to get on board with a government that is gracious, that is merciful, that is forgiving. One that is loving in such a way that there's no conditions attached except acceptance. If you believe in me, the Lord says, you will be saved. Anybody who calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And what day is a good day for salvation? Today. Well, verse 3, we live in such a way, in other words, setting the example, we live in such a way that no one will stumble because of us. Wow. When you think back over your life and sin, how many times can you say, you know what? I'm messed up in such a way that I probably did cause somebody to stumble. Or I joined in with sin and didn't bring them away from sin or walk away from sin, but rather I joined into it. It's sad to think back on our sin. It's difficult. But you know who doesn't think back on our sin? Jesus. And he says, I want you to partner with me, but I want you to do it in such a way that you leave the past behind and that you move forward in that repentance, move forward in walking away from sin so that no one will find fault with our ministry. Now, many in the Church of Corinth were questioning Paul's ministry and saying, hey, you're making yourself a lord over us, you and your guys. And the Church of Corinth had kind of a difficult time when it came to some of those issues. But Paul would say, no, I want you to understand that we are partnering with God, including you in Corinth. And I want you to live in a way that isn't mixing the world with God's way. There's a problem with putting a rotten apple in a whole bushel of apples. Would we do that? No, because we understand that if you put a rotten one in there, what's going to happen to the good ones? It's going to promote more rot. Why is it then that we bring things that are rotten into our life? God would say, Paul would say to the church at Corinth, don't do that. You need to live in a way that is about life. Jesus said he came to give us life and life more what? Abundantly. So the more that you and I set the example by living in love and doing those things that the Lord did for us, then man, we're going to watch the Lord do miraculous things in people's lives, in getting them saved. In everything we do, we show that we are true ministers of God. In other words, we're not paying attention to ourselves, but we're paying attention to the things that God would have us to do. You know what's amazing about that? When I set my selfishness aside, His will then becomes alive in my life and things just work out. It's amazing. A lot of people are looking for the encouraging word when literally we can have an encouraging life in Jesus. But we have to set aside the things that we think are going to make us happy and say, Lord, I'm going to do what you asked me to do in your word every day. And as we do that, then we are going to find that we are blessed beyond belief. Well, what happens when it doesn't go that way? Well, then we patiently endure troubles and hardships and calamities of every kind, as Paul did, and many of them that were going around and teaching the word. We have been beaten, been put in prison, faced angry mobs, worked to exhaustion, endured sleepless nights, and gone without food. You know, that is not always a great thing. I mean, who really wants to be patient? Patient means that I need to set aside some selfishness. hardships. Anybody here like them? No, we don't. What about calamities? Oh, those are the worst, you know? All of a sudden, something happens immediately, and it's disastrous. You know, beatings. I can't say that I have endured beatings for the sake of Jesus Christ. I'm very, very grateful that we live in a country that is free. But there, even as David pointed out, those folks in China, perhaps you may have seen some of the video clips from some of the lesser or more obscure news sites in China. They have rounded up the brute squad, so to speak, those people that were locking people into their homes during COVID. And those people were taken out into the streets and beaten. It's sad to see that kind of thing. They were probably just doing what their government was telling them to do. But you and I haven't suffered beatings for Jesus Christ. And yet there are many around the world that have. Is it worth it? Would it be worth it to take a beating for Christ? Yes, it would. Why? What has this world given to you to make you want to stay here so badly that you can say, no, this world is absolutely perfect. I love it just the way it is. No. heaven is where all of this stuff goes away. But thank the Lord we live in America. We are very blessed in that way. Anytime in prison that you can say, yep, it's from sharing the word of God, loving on people, no. Angry mobs, well, I've been around a few people that were grumpy or, you know, frustrated. But again, in America, we still live in freedoms to be able to share stuff. Exhaustion, yeah, I can say that there have been many, especially youth trip, that have been exhausting. Doing it for the Lord, sharing with our youth, that kind of thing. But not in the sense that Paul means this. Sailing around, traveling on foot, doing that. We're fortunate, man. We just hop on a plane or, you know, jump in the car, and that they didn't have any of that, you know. Sleeplessness. Yes, I've been there. Hunger. Yeah, I've been there, but, you know, most of us have a little more to live off of, that kind of thing, but not in the same way that Paul and these guys dealt with it. So, if this is Christianity, then why would anybody become a Christian? Right? I mean, if this is what you say, okay, well, if we're going to go share the gospel and we're going to set the example in love, that means that we've got to go through all of this. Well, you're going to go through it anyway. Okay? You're going to go through it anyway. The difference is you and I have hope in Jesus. Jesus said that not only did I come to give you life, but that more abundantly, but he says that my ways are higher than your ways. My thoughts are higher than your thoughts. You got to trust me in these things. But he says, I also have come to give you a future and a hope. Which means, how do we explain the difficulties in this world? There's only one way to explain them, and that is, this world does not belong to you and I anymore. God gave us dominion over it. Satan is in control. And so the things that we're seeing here are operating in a realm of evil. Whereas in heaven, it's all about the grace and the mercy of God. Which means that when God has given you his Holy Spirit, that we bring a little piece of heaven to a very difficult situation here on earth. That's why Paul does it. He says, because of the joy that I have in my heart, because of what God has done for me. And did Paul know forgiveness? Did he understand forgiveness? Well, absolutely he did. He was persecuting Christians. He was killing them. He was justifying it as part of God's word when they would twist the word. And then God knocked him on his hind end and said, hey, what are you doing? You know the word. You know these things. And Paul said, yeah, you're right. I've just been fighting against you. And he got saved. And now he says, it doesn't matter what I endure, because what really matters is what we do for the Lord. We prove ourselves by our purity. It's when you and I don't do what the world is doing, when you and I don't sin, that we set the example. When we do sin, we're saying, what about ourselves? We are selfish. I want to do what I want to do. When we do what the Lord is saying, we're saying, I'm going to set aside my selfishness, and in love, I'm going to do the things that the Lord asks me to. Why? Because what did he do for me? He loved me enough to die for me. And to die for my sin. So we prove ourselves, and if you're going to prove, it's not proving it to yourselves, it's not proving it to God. Who is it proving it to? The people that we live amongst, right? So we're proving it to others by our purity, by doing what's right, by our understanding. Not taking the word of God and just making it say what feels good to us, but being honest and saying, this is what the word says. And if we are obedient, God blesses us with our patience, our kindness, by the Spirit that tells us to do one thing, to go to the right or to go to the left, and by our what? Sincere love. You know, Jesus gave us 10 commandments, and how well did we do at keeping those? not very good. So when he came, God gave us two commandments. Jesus said, this is where it's at. You couldn't keep the 10, so I'm going to narrow it down to 2. I want you to love me with all your heart, with all your strength, with all your mind. And then I want you to do this. It's very similar to the first. I want you to love your neighbor as you love yourself. Most of us love ourselves because we comb our hair, we brush our teeth, we stuff our faces with food, and not just any food, you know, ice cream sundaes, hamburgers, you know, the stuff that may not be so good for us. But we love ourselves. Why? Because we take care of ourselves. We clean ourselves. We, you know, put on our glasses. We do those things that make us comfortable. And so Jesus said, I want you to set an example by love. I want you to do it with sincere love, not just going out and being churchy, but rather I want you to do it in all sincerity. And I like that. The word sincere means without hypocrisy. Hypocrisy was the word that was used when you put on a mask. In other words, you're faking it. You're not who you really are. You're pretending to be someone that you're not. We've all sinned and fallen short of God's glory. We need to be real, but we need to be real in such a way that we live apart from sin, to move away from that and in love say, God has forgiven me even though I don't deserve it. That's what grace is, unmerited, undeserved, unearned favor from God. And so we need to do it in all sincerity, not being a hypocrite. We faithfully preach the truth. We don't try and give an inspiring word, a message that's just going to tickle the ear, but one that is truth. Why? Because the truth of God doesn't return empty. There's a lot of preachers out there today that are just, I'm going to give you a good word. I'm going to encourage you and send you on your way, but never teach the truth of God. And so when people are faced with difficulty, they don't know what to do. You and I am proud of you guys for doing this, go through the word chapter by chapter, verse by verse. We're studying. Why? Because when you hide the word of God in your heart, as David would say, then it's difficult to sin. So we, in preaching the truth, do what is right. God's power is working in us. We use the weapons of righteousness in our right hand for attack and left hand for our defense. You know, when Nehemiah got permission from the king to go rebuild the walls, they had the sword in one hand and they had the brick in the other. Now, do we carry swords around? No. However, the word of God is known as a double-edged sword. So by studying the truth, we are carrying around the sword. Do we whack people over the head with our sword? No. Because Jesus didn't. No, huh? You need to... Although that might feel good at the moment, it's probably not a good way to get people saved. And then, the brick in the other, sword in one hand, the scriptures in one hand, and then what is that brick? What is that to you? It's a tool of building a wall, a defense from the enemy. How do we keep ourselves defended? Well, what did Jesus do when he was faced with Satan? What did he do? He quoted the word of God. He lived by the word of God. He, as all God, but yet also fully man, said, I am not going to sin. Even to the point where Satan said, hey, look, I will give all of this back to you, which is how another scripture we know that Satan does own all of this. I will give it all back to you if you just bow down to me. Boy, wouldn't that have been a bummer? Because we're all still stuck in sin, aren't we? We would have died in sin, and that would have been horrific for us. But Jesus said, no, not going to happen. I like that about him. He never gave up. He never quit. And in partnering with him, he would say, I want you to preach the truth. I want you to do what's right. Work with the brick, but also with the sword. That tool of defense in one hand and the sword in the other, the truth. The truth, the scripture is a double-edged sword. You can't argue with the truth. You can make up excuses, but you cannot argue the truth. It's like oil and water. The oil always rises to the top every single time. The truth is the same way. Well, we serve God whether people honor us or despise us, whether they slander us or praise us. We are honest, but they call us imposters. They call us hypocrites. Why do they do that? Well, because they recognize that we're still sinners. We still make mistakes, don't we? So they say, I thought you were a Christian. That's just a more polite way of saying hypocrite. How come you do this? I thought you were a Christian. Man, how many times could we agree with them on that? How many times are they absolutely right? God would say, in partnering with me, if you're keeping the sword in one hand and you're working for me on the other, then it doesn't matter. Even if they call you an imposter, at least they're watching. At least they're seeing. At least they're sitting in the seat next to you, watching you take the key, put it in the ignition, turn it over, putting it into drive. Now, they're paying attention. Why? Because as you and I live our lives and they are watching us, they're going to see us filled with joy. They're going to see us filled with happiness. They're going to see us go through difficulties and trials and tribulations and yet still come out on the other side saying, God, you have been so good to me. To see us going to church every week and being faithful to praise him, even when you can't remember how to play the song or sing the song. It doesn't matter. We're praising God. And so as we serve God, whether people honor us or despise us, slander us or praise us, we are honest, even if they call us imposters. We are ignored, even though we are well known, which is interesting, isn't it? People know that we're here. People know that the church of Corinth was there. They knew it. People know that Happy Camp Christian Fellowship is here. But many times they just say, I don't want to go hang out at church. Football's on, or, you know, there's something better on the news. No, there's not. But they ignore. Until when? Until they're going through it, huh? Okay? So we live close to death, every one of us. I mean, we can walk right out on the street and whammo. You know, it's over. We don't know. Paul said, hey, we live close to death, and yet we're still alive. We have been beaten, but they didn't kill us, which means we can keep sharing. Our hearts ache, and yet we always have joy. We are poor, but we give spiritual riches to others. Notice that he doesn't say, but I am rich. He says, no, my job is to give spiritual riches to others. He already knows that he's rich. And so he says, my job is to share the wealth. God doesn't give it to us, spiritually speaking, so that we would hold it under a bushel. Hide it under a bushel, no. I'm gonna let it shine. That idea. But even if you're blessed financially, hey, sharing with others, meeting needs is a cool thing. Paul says, hey, I'm going to share of the riches of God. We own nothing, yet we have everything. Do you ever feel that way? You ever feel like, yes, we live in a very poor town, but we are so blessed here. It blows my mind. I have never lived in an area that is so giving. You ask somebody for help here, you're going to get it. And that is an amazing thing. To watch out for one another, to take care of one another, to love each other in such a way that we can say that about our town is pretty amazing. And as God continues to work through you and through me, we're going to see more of that. Verse 11, oh dear Corinthian friend. I like the fact that Paul calls them friends. Even though they haven't been very good friends to Paul, we weren't very good friends to Jesus, and yet what does Jesus say to us? I call you friends, but I also call you my brothers and sisters. Oh, dear Corinthian friends, we have spoken honestly to you. Our hearts are open to you. There is no lack of love on our part, but you have withheld your love from us. Paul says, look, I'm going to keep loving you and loving you. I'm not going to give up on you. Even when you have kind of given up on us, you don't trust me. You don't think that I'm really called to be an apostle. Hey, I'm calling you friends. My heart is open to you, and I'm going to continue to love you. How is the example set? Love. It is living by love, and that is what Paul said, there is no lack of love on our part, but you have withheld your love from us. I am asking you to respond as if you were my own children. Isn't that interesting that Paul didn't look at them as just, that's the church over there, but he looked at every one of them as his own kids. Boy, there's many times when we didn't understand why dad or why mom was making a decision for us. We thought that maybe, well, man, that's just not being fair. We don't always understand it, but then later on in life when we have experienced the truth and the wisdom and the understanding that they had, then we can look back and say, ah, I get it. We can very easily do the same with our life in the Lord. Lord, I don't always understand, but I will rejoice in you. It's very difficult for me to rejoice in this difficulty, but Father, I can rejoice in you. So I'm asking you to respond as if you were my own kids. I love you like my own kids. Open your hearts to us. Don't team up with those who are unbelievers. Now this is interesting because if you and I are setting an example, does that mean we need to be exclusive to other Christians and never work with or alongside other believers? No, that is not what God is saying here. What he is saying here is, right at the beginning, we are partners with God in the ministry, setting an example. Part of that is how you conduct business at home, at work, and in your relationships. Don't team up with those who are unbelievers. And I would say that that even goes as far as how you believe. I was dating a girl years ago who was a believer in Jesus Christ. However, the church there practiced that if you sinned one time, that God snatched away his salvation. And you had to come and kneel down every Sunday and receive Jesus Christ back into your life. Now, I'm not Jesus, but that would get annoying to me if I was. Especially when I said that I died one time for how many sins? All of them, which means we're all forgiven. All we're left with is a choice. And Jesus would say, if you choose me, then I'm going to make you my child. Now, how difficult would it be to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior if you knew that every time you turned around, he rejected you as a child because of something that you did that was wrong? Boy, that would be frustrating to have that type of parent. Unless you are perfect, you are not my child. So even in that kind of a relationship, And it's like, this isn't going to work. Because I do not believe that God loves us in that way, that he would snatch away and say, well, you're not my kid now. It doesn't work. And so teaming up with the unbelievers can mean a couple of different things. It means, in a church sense, not to maybe hang out with those that aren't seeing eye to eye. That's probably why we have different kinds of churches. We have different flavors. Do I believe that those people in that particular church are going to be saved? Yeah, they're just missing out on a lot of blessing. Do they believe in Jesus Christ for their salvation? Yes, they're just misunderstood because they're not really studying the Word. They're spending more time on their knees every Sunday down at the altar asking for forgiveness that's already been given. And so, rather than rejoicing in the blessing that they already have, and then they could go to teaching the Word, they're stuck in just, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me, forgive me, when Jesus said the work's already done. So teaming up with unbelievers is kind of goes both ways. Christians that don't believe in the same way, but also this means unbelievers, those that do not accept the Lord. Man, if you get married and your husband, your wife, is not a believer, it is an uphill battle. But I am glad that the battle belongs to who? The Lord. So it isn't a matter of trying to fight them and force them into the kingdom. It's a matter of setting an example and loving them through it. Most of you, if not all of you, have been married at some point in life. In combining that relationship, is it easy? No, it isn't. Even for those that are together. But if you marry an unbeliever, how much more difficulty do you have? Well, you might have both been unbelievers at the beginning, and then when you came, one or the other became a believer, and then what happens? It's still an uphill battle. But we don't have to rejoice in the battle. We get to rejoice in the Lord and set the example. But how can righteousness be a partner with wickedness? Okay, we cannot live where there's evil and righteousness going on together. It's a battle. How can light live with darkness? You bring light and darkness into the same room, it's a battle. Although I can tell you which one's gonna work out best. What harmony can there be between Christ and the devil? You bring Jesus and you bring Satan into the picture. Of course, I can tell you who's gonna win it. And who is it? It's Jesus every single time. Okay? And what union can there be between God's temple and idols? Well, that's easy. Because God's temple is a reality. You and I are the temple of the Holy Spirit. We're real. What's the idol? It's basically a fake. It's the hypocrite. There's nothing there. Rock, wood, stubble, a painting, money, whatever it might be that takes that place of God in your life, okay, it's never going to satisfy. Well, for we are the temple of the living God. So what does this mean? It means that as being an example means that in every aspect of our life, we need to do what is right. We need to live in the light. We need to hang out with the Lord and partner with him, that we need to be that temple that God intends us to be. And when that happens, it is literally as easy as flipping on the light switch. The darkness goes away. When we're doing what's right, people recognize that. Even in a relationship, and something changes. When we are in business, okay, and we do what is right, not partnering with an unbeliever and say, well, you know, maybe we'll just cheat a little bit. No, okay? When we do what is right, man, it's like turning on the light switch. The darkness flees. God would say in his word that when you resist the enemy, he flees from you. Paul is saying, hey, when you and I set the example, this is how we overcome evil. We overcome it with good, with the Lord, and with partnering with God, living our lives as the temple of the Holy Spirit. As God said, I will live in them and I will walk among them. I will be their God and they will be my people. Therefore, come out from among unbelievers. Separate yourselves from them, says the Lord God. Don't touch their filthy things and I will welcome you. I will be your father and you will be my sons and daughters, says the Lord Almighty. Why does God tell his people to stay away from evil things and people that just want to do evil things? Why not partner with them? Because my ways are higher than your ways. My thoughts are higher than you. I came that you would have a future and a hope. Anything aside from my way is going to lead to destruction. Why? Because the wages of sin, it's a natural occurrence. When you sin, you are inviting in death to a situation. And God would say, no, I want to live in you. I want to walk among you. I want to call you my people. I want to call you my sons and daughters. And if that's the case, then we, as an example, need to live by love. How did Jesus set the example when he was here? Did he love people? Unbelievably. And how many people came running to him and ran away from government? Thousands. And what happened? Oh, the government just became jealous. The church became jealous. How does he get all of the followers? Why are they paying attention to him? Because people really intuitively want one thing deep down in their hearts. They want to be loved. And you and I get to partner with God. And what happens when we don't? Then the love goes away. It just appears to the world as selfishness. They don't care. They're a hypocrite. And so Paul would say to the church of Corinth and would say to us today, you need to be real. You need to be real. And to set an example, you need to live by love. Well, what love? The love that I showed you. Dying to self and saying, God, whatever you want me to do, I will do it. I'm not going to stick my finger in somebody's face and beat them over the head with the word. I'll just tell them how much the word has told me that you love me, that you forgive me, and that that is available to everyone. That's what partnering with God means. It means to simply live by love, live by the love that he has given to each one of us. Amen. Father, we thank you so much that you have loved us deeply, that you would die on the cross for our sin. Father, there's many times where it is maybe difficult to do what's right because we're afraid of how others will perceive us. And yet, Lord, so many people perceived you as a loving, kind, compassionate person. Father, if we follow that same example, then, Lord, they will hear your love. They will understand forgiveness. And they will receive the same thing that you and I have as the church received, which is forgiveness, grace, mercy. Father, teach us those things. Teach us to be more like you. Teach us to love in such a way that we are not inviting in the darkness and the evil, but rather rejoicing in you. Father, we love you. Help us to set the same example that you have set for us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, God bless you. Have a great week, and we will see you next week. Uh-oh. Thank you.
to talk to
really
old
nice,
about
you know,
being available in
case
trust me. I mean, when you show up to in case things get really bad.
The abuse I get.
Right, I'll still have a way to maybe to leave because I'd have to get him up and ready.
Right?
Yeah.
Understand.
I'm all decked out. I wanted to come in early and be like, what happened?
I'm a fan too. My sister's
oh, nice. Nice.